Thanks for coming. Last time I was here, I went through an introduction to 4K for photographers. So we're going to touch on that a little bit just to kind of get you up to speed. But if you were not here for the last class, you can always watch that on B&H's YouTube page and get the full 2 hours of the concepts and whatnot. That's me, Giulio Sciorio. I'm watching you here, there, there, and there. I've been shooting full-time since 2005, but I've been shooting full-time because I love it since the 90s. And I kind of taken that enthusiast mentality into my professional world. I love shooting with small cameras. I like shooting light and easy because it allows me to put the focus of what I'm doing on the creativity. And that's why I do what I do, so I can be creative and self-expressed. I think right now is such an amazing time to be a photographer, regardless if you're just getting into it today or if you're a weekend warrior or a professional. There's so many cool opportunities to grow as an artist, to be self-expressed, and if you're doing it for a living, to grow your business as well. So what we're going to do is go through some basics of what 4K is. I got a small presentation. I want to go through that kind of quickly so I can do some hands-on and show you how I'm using 4K technology in the real world. We're going to go over some stuff I shoot, like street photography, travel, then a couple assignments as well. And then we'll do some Q&A together, and you can come up here and check out the gear because we got some pretty amazing stuff that I had brought and then some stuff that my friends at Panasonic brought, like the G7. I will not be covering this in depth in my presentation because it just came out. This is one of like two or three in the country, but it's pretty awesome. Everything I will talk about in a presentation can apply to the G7 as well. So let's start. By the way, that's my blog, Small Camera, Big Picture. If you want to learn more stuff, it's all free. Check it out. I got a lot more details on smallcamerabigpicture.com. And then if you just plug my name into Google or YouTube, Instagram, anywhere, you'll find me as well. So I'm going to go ahead and, smallcamerabigpicture.com, and I'm going to go ahead and skip past that. And you can always ask me at the end, I'll tell you again as well. So briefly, what makes a video clip? Video is one of those things that I find can be very complicated, but it doesn't have to be. You know, video's got some deep roots in a broadcast and goes way, way back, just like photography does. And if you look online, if you talk to some people about video, it can get really complicated quick. It's a whole different kind of language than what photographers are used to. And a whole set of tools that look maybe familiar or unfamiliar to photographers, like something like this. But at the end of the day, video is nothing more than photography. And my philosophy on video as a photographer is that I shoot it like a photographer. So this is one of my kits that I take with me on assignments. I don't have a video tripod. I don't have a lot of video specific tools. I got photographic tools that work as what I'm used to, like a still camera. And I mix back and forth. But if we were to take that video clip and we were to open that video clip up, we would see a couple things here. We'd have a series of still photos, because that's what video is. It's a series of still photographs. And then we'd have audio track, and the audio track is recorded either by an external microphone or the built-in microphone on the camera. And video is created like this regardless of which device you use. So you got two components. You got the stills and the audio track, and that's all that's inside of a video clip. This is contained inside of what's called a container or a wrapper, not like LL Cool J, like a candy bar, okay? It wraps together the stills and the video, and the stills, excuse me, and the audio. And so the wrapper would be like an MOV, or perhaps you've seen an MP4 that your camera makes. That's a wrapper. It's taking that content and it's kind of putting it into a folder, and it allows your computer to read it sequentially, so it plays back like a video. Now that said, every frame of video, being a still photo with traditional HD, is roughly 2 megapixels per frame of video. I'm kind of being a little loose on the exact specs. I'm not necessarily a spec junkie, so if I'm not 100% right, that's why I'm kind of loose on this stuff. So roughly 2 megapixels per frame of video. And that looks great online. It looks great on your phone and on your tablet. But as photographers, I don't think any of us in here are using a 2-megapixel camera, right? No one? Okay. I'm waiting for someone to be like, yeah, and I rock it out.
Well, I have one, but I don't use it anymore.
Okay, well, there you go. So they become like paperweights because it's just older technology. And the reason why we're not shooting 2-megapixel still images is because when you take that into post, maybe you want to lighten it up a little bit or darken it or add some color to it. The file, there's just not enough detail there and the file starts to break down. And that doesn't make for a good photograph. But when it's coming by you, boom, 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 at 30 frames a second, you don't really notice it as much. With 4K, that's a huge jump. That's about 4 times the size. That's an 8-megapixel frame for each frame of video. Now, when I started shooting professionally in 2005, I was shooting magazine covers with a 5-megapixel camera. And to be able to do that now with an 8-megapixel frame of video is really amazing. And even now, for whatever magazines are still around, really 8 megapixels is plenty for that application. So to be able to shoot that in the form of video opens up a whole range of creativity for photographers and artists as well. Now, that's not where it ends though. So this is 4K for photographers. Maybe next year we'll do 6K for photographers. So 6K technology is here, and 6K is 19 megapixels per frame of video. And that technology is here. It's just out of the reach of most of us. It's made for like broadcast and very specific applications. And so is 8K. And that's where it becomes really intense, 33 megapixel per frame of video. So while we're talking about 4K today, in the future we'll be talking about 6 and 8K and then probably beyond. Because really what the holdup is just processing power. You know, and the other things too, like the memory and stuff, it all kind of evolves together. Now I have seen 8K displays in Vegas during NAB, and that was so real. I thought I was looking into an aquarium. It was like an underwater scene. It was so real, I can't really put it into words other than I saw it and I felt a little disoriented and a little off balance because I wasn't sure. It was like my brain was telling me I was looking through glass, but the rest of me was like, no, it's actually a screen. It was like this moment where I kind of lost balance. It's so real. When we get to that point, it'll be quite crazy. So how does that work? How do these formats work in with most of our popular still photo formats? So you can see the difference between 6K and a 24 megapixel still photo, very similar in size. 8K and 36 megapixel, very similar size. Then I put the 50 megapixel in there because that's gigantic. And at some point, we'll probably shoot video in that size as well. Now here's the opportunity, and this is why all this is really happening, is because we have over 1 billion iOS devices alone in the market, not to mention Android and Windows, and I think there's a Firefox OS. We're living in the age of screens. I think most of us have a smartphone of some sort, and probably a lot of us have a form of tablet. Now these devices can broadcast video, audio, and also can display stills. So that's where the content is being consumed. So it only makes sense to have cameras that can capture still photo, video, and audio, and that are also photographic, photographer friendly. And that's really why I've been using these guys for my bread and butter. These are the 3 cameras that I use for everything I do, and I find it very, I wanna say easy, because nothing really in photography I would say is really easy, but there's less of a barrier for me to create the content I create to grow my business and to be self-expressed with these devices, with the Lumix cameras, than anything I've had before. And I've had a variety of equipment. And there's a lot of reasons. I mean, you got the live view. Basically, you're shooting with your GH4, your LX100, almost like a giant smartphone. You get a live view. So if it's too dark, you lighten it. If it's too light, you darken it. You get built-in filters, which actually work really well if you use them right. It's just, there's a lot of tools in the toolbox that make life easier. Autofocus and video, which I'll be showing you how that works, that's fantastic for anybody shooting weddings, kids, animals. It'll lock on their face, and as they move around, it keeps them in focus. Another reason why I love these cameras is because they shoot in what's called a 4K photo mode. So remember, 4K video or any kind of video is a series of still frames. So the 4K photo mode is a specific 4K video mode designed for photographers, hence the name 4K Photo. So it does a few things actually. One of the things it does is, first of all, it allows you to choose which aspect ratio you want to capture your video in without losing a lot of detail. So for instance, if you want to go from a 16:9, maybe you want to shoot square video. You can do square video at 4K, roughly 8 megapixels, or 16:9, or 4/3, and you see all this live on the screen. It's quite a remarkable thing to be able to shoot square video at such a high resolution. And then, it's because it's designed for photographers, it's going to help freeze the action more. And in the camera, you can choose whatever frame you want and pull that frame out, makes a copy of that frame, doesn't touch the video, makes a copy of that frame, and it stores all your photographic metadata into that frame, ISO, shutter speed, aperture, time of day. And if you're synchronized with your camera with a smartphone, even GPS coordinates as well. And then from that point, what I like to do is I'll Wi-Fi that frame of video from one of my cameras to my tablet or my smartphone. And it's a real fun way to capture video and stills at the same time, and also to capture the kind of things that may be difficult to capture just by hitting the shutter release a bunch of times or using the motor drive. And that could be like, again, animals, if you're doing birding, children, pets. I got two cats, and the moment I put a camera on them, they stopped doing that, whatever they were doing. It was super cute. So I can let the camera do a 4K loop, so it runs 4K video, then loops back around to the front. When I got exactly what I want, I hit the shutter release, and it actually keeps all those frames, and I choose what I want. It's pretty remarkable. So now we got a quick overview. I want to talk to you briefly about my workflows. There's a couple kinds of workflows I do, one for commercial work and then one for my own personal work, and there's always some overlap. And then I want to talk to you how I use these specific cameras. The reason why I say there's overlap is because even with these devices, I have an iPad Air and an iPhone 6, they can actually work with 4K files. The iPhone's a little slow with 4K files, but the iPad Air, I've actually done 4K video edits on an iPad. That should, I hope, inspire you to try it and also let you know how powerful the tools we have are. You don't have to have gigantic computers and tons of hardware to make this happen. So you can do it on a tablet and a laptop as well. So let's talk about the stuff I do for work and play. So the GH4, this is the flagship Lumix camera. I mostly use my GH4s for commissions. That's a company, ad agency, will hire me directly to create a particular type of image, still and video based. And I've not been hired to shoot just still photos in years. It's always video and then some stills, and then now sometimes I also capture audio as well. But I also use this for personal assignments because it has so much tools available inside the GH4 for different types of motion capture and audio sampling. If I'm doing a personal assignment that has a very specific requirement, then I'll also use a GH4 for that. The LX100, where is it? There it is. This guy, if you see my LX100 after the presentation, you'll notice it's a little beat up. It's because I don't leave the house without this. This is the one I take with me everywhere, and actually, I have with my personal bag, I wear it, I clip it on, and I just knock it in everything, and it just keeps ticking. This camera is essentially almost a miniature GH4. It's got an F1.7 Leica zoom. It's an amazing low light lens. Shoots 4K video, shoots great stills, and I love that it's all external control for the most part. But I use this, occasionally I use it on assignment. I've done a couple assignments where I'd use this along the GH4. I couldn't tell the difference afterwards, and the clients were happy, so that is a good testament for this little camera. And then on top of that, because it's with me everywhere, I'm using this a lot for casual photography and a lot of times for play if I'm just out having a good time with my friends or my family. If I'm going to Instagram something, you know, the burrito pictures, you know, pictures of a salad or whatever it is I'm doing, I'll shoot with this. And then the FZ1000, this is a little larger than the GH4, but it's because it has a 16 times optical zoom. This is my vacation camera right here, because I have everything I need in one lens, macro, telephoto, everything. And this is a spectacular camera for casual, for play. If you kind of do any kind of wildlife, or if you want to get into 4K at a budget, this is a spectacular camera. In fact, I just took this to Southern Arizona and had an awesome time because there's so much distance between you and everything else in the desert, and you can really zoom in on animals and stuff. It's fantastic. Plus, and I'll show you this later, I like to shoot macro, but I hate bugs. So I'm just kind of, you know, they get close to me. It's my wife's cool with them. I'm not cool with them. But I use this massive zoom to maybe even from 5 feet away to get really close. And I handhold and I get these amazing 4K images of insects from 5 or 6 feet away handheld with this. And I'll show you that those images. They're just amazing. So let's go into some basic workflow concepts. So this is the kind of workflow, the basic workflow I do for commissions and assignments, whether that assignment comes from a client or it's from myself. I typically capture the card. That means I'm shooting right to the memory card in the camera. I don't tether. Now the GH4 can tether, but I don't like to really tether. I like to be loose and like to move around with my subjects, which are typically portraits. Especially if I'm using something like this, I wouldn't really want to tether. If I do, even though this does not have a tether capability, neither does the FZ1000, I'll actually tether wirelessly to my tablet. And that's come in really handy. So I'll hand the tablet to the client, they can have a seat. I usually bring an extra Wi-Fi router to keep the signal nice and strong. And as I'm shooting, I'm dumping low-res JPEGs, 8 or 9 megapixel JPEGs, to the tablet, you know, and the client's selecting which ones they like, and I can do that with the 4K photo images as well. So I do that on occasion, but typically I'll shoot right to card. I'll do a backup in the field to an external drive, usually one of these rugged type drives. These are real handy. If you drop them from a few feet, you should be okay. It's best if you're using a solid state drive. Those are real nice. There's no moving parts. They're less likely to break if you're to drop them. And then when I'm done shooting, I lock the memory cards and I file them away in a card holder. I have like different card holders for clear memory and then ones that have been used up. That's essentially my capture workflow. A lot of the assignments I do now, I do either by myself or I do with a couple people on a team. I don't usually have the art director there, so maybe in remote locations where I was in New Mexico at the spaceport doing some photos and some video. And the client was in Austin, so we would Wi-Fi to a smartphone and then send them images for approval on the spot, which was really handy. When I'm back in my office, let me just say that I do a lot of my post-production, even for assignments, on this laptop right here. So if I'm flying somewhere or if I'm in a taxi or whatnot, I'll do a lot of work on the laptop. They're strong enough now to get a lot of the work done. So I'll usually start my edit on this laptop right here. This is the very first generation MacBook Pro. It is certainly not a cutting edge laptop anymore. It was like 3-4 years ago. But it still handles 4K files quite well. But when I'm in my office, then I will load that content from the external drives onto my desktop on a working drive, on a solid state drive that's made just for the edit. And then I'll also back it up simultaneously to just one of the larger, I think it's like a 4 terabyte drive. And that's kind of how I do my backups. Post-production is in Creative Cloud. Final Cut 10 for video, because I find it to be very easy compared to Premiere for photography mindset to kind of get up and going. And then specialty apps, like Flixel is what I do a lot of my animated photography with. And then also a lot of apps by a company called MacFun. It's P-H-U-N. I've never been like a plugin guy until recently. I got a demo of these apps. And then I got the apps, and on an assignment, it saved me about a day and a half so I can make my deadline, which was awesome. And I ended up looking like the hero to the client for like, I think it was like $200. And the images looked cool. So I was pulling frames and then mixing it with stills, and it was fantastic. So that's essentially how I do my commission-based workflow. Now for casual and play, it's so much more straightforward. And I think that this type of workflow that I'm gonna tell you is going to be more of a workflow that I do for everything in the near future. But again, I'm capturing a card. I'm usually backing up to a tablet from a card reader. I prefer to back up when possible to like my iPad or Surface Pro 3. from a card reader, because that way I get the JPEGs, because I shoot JPEG and RAW. I get the RAW files, and I get the 4K files, and I get all the varieties of my HD. I get all my media at the same time. And then the iPad, for instance, will back up automatically to iCloud, Dropbox, whatever service I'm using at that time. And at the same time, because it's backing up to the cloud, it's also backed up to this laptop and my other devices, or I'll send a link, a Dropbox link to my client in advance, and I'll say, this is where the content's gonna be backed up. And then I'll look at it the next day, and there's the content, it's backed up. And then I'll lock and file my SD cards. This is a really easy way to shoot. Straightforward, allows me to focus on being creative and doing more work with the camera, which is what I like to do. My preference is to be creating with the camera as opposed to being trapped behind a computer. And then the post-production, very basic. Since it's already backed up on the device and stored in the cloud, my backup's already done for me. And then I'll use often Creative Cloud mobile apps, and then I'll use stuff like iMovie. I mean, right? It's good. It's totally good. And then specialty apps. That varies, because every day there's some new amazing app for your tablet. Like, oh, it's great, and it's free, or it's $5. So those specialty apps can range from like Cinemagraph Pro, or there's one app that I just wrote a review on and a tutorial. You should download this app. It's called Replay. Right now it's only for iOS. You got to look for Replay app. It's an auto editing software for video, and it is good. I've used some in the past, and they've had kind of like a little cheesy templates for my taste. This one will actually deliver a really good quality file. It'll upload it for you. As you're downloading the content to the app, it'll actually edit it for you, and it'll see the edit. It's amazing. I did a whole tutorial sample because I was really inspired by this app. You definitely got to check it out. And then, of course, I share it. And for me, that's why I love shooting. I love shooting, but I also like sharing. I like having that connection to, now because of the web, with another human being in a different part of the world, and they can see what I'm seeing, and I can see what they're seeing. And I think that's really, powerful for creative people to be able to make this content and then share it, and share it in a way that is empowering to everybody involved. All right, cool. Now we're gonna get into some hands-on. So let's get into some street photography and travel first. Everybody here shoots street in some form, right? We all live in a city, right? I mean, we're gonna shoot street. You can't help but go outside and see something that's amazing, either amazingly good or weird, or it's often amazing. And street photography is fun. It's how I started shooting. It's accessible to everybody. It's truly art for the people by the people, especially when you're shooting and you're like Wi-Fiing over to your smartphone, you're sharing it online. It's really something that's all inclusive. And travel is often the same way. We're traveling, we're doing something in a foreign country or even in our own neighborhood, and it's something that's beautiful and inspiring, and you capture it without having to really make a big setup. And when you're able to shoot on the street and shoot with travel, and shoot light, we're really present to what's in front of us. We're capturing something spontaneously. And that's where the 4K photo mode comes in beautifully. So if you see something happening, especially if you're in a place where you can't stop whoever is doing something amazing and say, can I pose you, or whatever, you're shooting 4K photo, it's recording video at 8 megapixels per frame in a loop, and then you can pull that frame out, plus you got the video clip. So let me show you some ways how I do it. First of all, I try to do the 4K photo mode in camera. I can't hook up a camera to the screen, but I can show you after the workshop. But I'm going to show you two ways to pull frames from video, because that's essentially what we're doing. I'm going to show you, if you're a Mac user, how to do this in a Photos app. And then if you're a Mac or Windows user, I'm going to show you how to do the exact same thing in Lightroom. So it's two ways to do it. There's not one way that's better than the other. They both have pluses and minuses, and isn't that like the paradox of photography? There's no like perfect camera. We can't get it all on one device. But this is some cool stuff. So I talked about the macro earlier. This is all 4K. I didn't do any color correction of this stuff. This is all shot on this guy from about 5 to 6 feet away. You play your video, just going to let this play for a moment. This is not an edited capture. It's exactly how I captured it. It's amazing how clear 4K video is, even on a screen, you know, that's not 4K. I mean, you can really appreciate, you can appreciate what you're seeing here, and regardless of what screen. Just like you would with a still photo, right? So if you're shooting, you know, 30 megapixel images, you don't have a screen that does 30 megapixel, it's not a 30 megapixel display, but you can still appreciate it. The same here. Now, one thing that's cool is because we're shooting 4K, and this is program mode. When I'm on vacation, I'm on vacation. I shoot in automatic mode. I let the camera do all the work for me. So this here is in focus. I'm gonna click on this little guy right here, just a little drop-down menu. And I'm gonna export a frame to pictures. So what it does, instead of keeping it in the Photos app, hopefully down the road it'll change this, it exports it to your pictures folder as a TIFF. There's your 8 megapixel image. You can just kind of, you can zoom in and you can get exactly what you want. And then you can re-import it back in your Photos app or Photoshop or whatever. But because we shot video, I don't know if you guys noticed that rack focus, that was done by the camera. So the camera's continuously monitoring what's happening, right? Because we're shooting 30 frames a second. So I moved the camera over a little bit because I wanted to get a shot of the bees. And it auto-focuses in video on the bees. And I'll capture that frame as well. Anybody ever try to focus in video? It's not easy. It's tough, and it's really, it's not intuitive for photographers to you got a screen moving around, and you're trying to zoom and you're trying to focus. It's like we're trying to juggle too much, and it really it takes me out of being present to the image. So having the camera be my partner and focus on the video and being able to capture 4K really makes a big difference for this kind of stuff. I'll do one more and then I'm going to save some for Lightroom. So here's another one. I mean, right away, it looks like I'm fine with this. I can actually pull this out. And most of my video captures, you'll notice they start off like this because I'm shooting like a photographer. I'm only thinking of that initial frame. I'm not thinking 5 or 6 seconds into the future. I always think of like a 500th of a second. So a lot of them start off like a photograph, and so I'll pull that initial frame. Actually, you know what? That's kind of cool too. Let me get that. It's so fun shooting like this because you just watch it and you're like, there's an image, there's a shot. And in this case, he flies away. And now we got a macro shot of the flower. And so now we've got, where is it? That one as well. And then you can always re-import these back into the Photos app. And because I'm doing this in the Photos app, it's also synchronizing with my iPhone, with my iPad, all my other devices automatically. So I'm pulling these frames, it's backing it up in the cloud. Now let's do the other two in Lightroom. So let's do this one. We have Lightroom users here, right? Okay, right, it's kind of like this, become the standard now for raw processing for a lot of us. Lightroom is okay with video. It's not, I wanna say it's good, you'll even notice it'll stutter even on a new computer with 4K. It just kind of like you're playing it and all of a sudden it slows down, which I don't understand why. I don't have an answer for you if you're curious, but it's still usable. So there's a couple things you got to do. You got to open up this stuff down here. See that cog? As soon as you open that up, you get a little scrub bar here, and you can scrub. You can see how it's kind of like choking to catch up. You can trim your video, or you can play it, or you can advance frame by frame. So let's see how well it does. Whoops. That looked pretty good. I'm going to go back a few. No, so you got some motion blur. There you go. I'm going to capture that frame. Now watch. Watch the camera do the work here. I mean, come on. It's focusing on the head of a butterfly from 5 feet away, handheld in 4K. I mean, that's like slow clap right there. Just for that. I mean, if you ever try to do this stuff without the aid of one of these cameras, it's not easy. This is the first time I've ever shot 4K photo with any kind of animals. And when I was doing this, looking through the viewfinder, I was just like, my God, this is amazing. It was like I like saw like what's going to happen in the future. It's like crazy. But so you can, I get really excited about this stuff. I think this is so much fun. We can just kind of forward to whatever frame you want. I think I may have had some better ones earlier. Oh, wait. Let's see. No, I don't want the butterfly, but that's kind of cool. Whoops. Do you see how Lightroom kind of, it's a little jittery, so you have to be patient with it. That looks cool too. So we'll go back here and we can see here are the frames we pulled. And from here, if you want to do something, if you want to go into your develop module, because it is a photo, right? You go into your develop module, whoops, and you can do, you know, whatever work you want to do to the photo, just like you would with anything else, right? And we can get crazy with the colors if we want. Let's add some grain, let's make it hip, cool. So, you know, you can do whatever you want. It's a photograph, and then I can go back and I can pull that again and pull it again and get a variety of images out of that. What's the other one? I think this one. So same thing here. Well, there's my initial frame. I'll capture that. We'll play this. Oops. It's huffing. So that's pretty cool too. I can capture that one. And I know towards the back, I think the butterfly, there you go. Flies away, and we can get a shot of a flower as well. So you're able to get, you know, 2, 3, 4 frames, plus you get the video clip, which if you take those video clips and you put them into an app like Replay, now you get a cool video as well. And then you can put those photos into that app and you get that as well. So if you like doing video editing on an iOS device, of the two workflows, the Photos app is going to be a little easier because it synchronizes with your iOS device. So it'll synchronize all these photos and video. If you like to use Premiere and the Adobe Cloud Creative Cloud suite of apps, then Lightroom is a good solution as well. I'll tell you what. Why don't we do some street photography while we're here? If you've ever been to downtown LA recently, there's a lot of gentrification going on, and on Broadway in particular. On one side of the street, you have all these new buildings going up. On the other side, you got like the Ace Hotel and all these hip places. And in between, you have the old part of downtown Los Angeles. And I had found this place, an actual fully functioning arcade from the 80s with the neon signs. It wasn't like a redo. It's like this place is like falling to pieces. It just was there. And I only had the LX100 with me. And you know, this is so easy to be discreet. And because when you shoot 4K photo, you shoot it like a photographer, right? Using the shutter release button to start and stop that capture. I actually hold mine like this with my thumb. And I just kind of walk around and I just kind of like let the camera just like this. It's so chill. I'm just like, because I'm like, if I'm shooting this direction, I'm capturing 4K. If I'm shooting this way, I'm capturing 4K. It doesn't matter. Just let the camera do the work, you know, for this kind of stuff. And it was a ton of fun. So I'm just going to capture that one. You'll see that this video gets a little wobbly there towards the end. But that's okay, because we're not trying to do a steady cam shot. I'm just trying to pull some frames. So that was cool. Actually, let's go back. Let's pull that one. I think I did that one. So I usually will pull these frames in camera, because I want that metadata. I want to know what aperture and ISO and all that I shot. From here, I could just kind of crop it. There we go, I think that'll work. maybe straighten it out, whatever I wanted to do. But I do a lot of this stuff in camera, because you can crop and do a lot of it in camera. Here's another one. That's a pretty sweet bike. And again, when I set these up, I'm often setting these up with the first frame in mind. And then a lot of times, whatever I get afterwards is like a bonus. So I captured that one already. Probably not a whole lot there. Let's switch over to the Photos app and do some in the Photos app. This one's cool. Already, it looks like a pretty cool image to begin with. I'm gonna export that frame. This has I like to tune my images in camera. So this is kind of set to a vivid is what I really like to start off with, a vivid picture style. And then I'll usually lift the blacks up a little bit, the black levels, because there's built-in curves just like you would in Photoshop. And I do that in camera because I like to, the more I do in camera, the less I do in post. So with the LX100, what I do is I lift the blacks up three points. The GH4, it's two. And with the FZ1000, it's 4 points typically. So I like a little more detail in the shadows. And that's what I did here. And then I altered the white balance so I can warm it up. You can see it's a little more of a warm image than what you would get typically straight out of a digital camera. So let's play this through. There's a lot going on there. But can you kind of, you know, when you're playing this through, if you play it through again, we can start to see different photos, right? So we could probably use something like that, which I think I grabbed already. I'll do it again. And then we could inch over. Let's just scrub this over. That's kind of cool too. And I'll just take those images, yeah, there's three, and I'll import those back in here. So it's actually capturing the black bars on the side with the Photos app. I don't believe Lightroom does this, but it's just a matter of cropping that out if you don't want that in. And then from this point, you could throw a filter on there if you want. Probably a little too much. Then you can go in and do more, whatever else you wanted to it as well. Let's do another one. Let's see. What? I present to you that guy. Pretty awesome. You know, so this is one of those times where if you see a dude, and I know this is a character on Telemundo, I believe. But if you see a guy come by like this on a scooter, you can't. It may not be easy to just kind of run out on the street and be like, "You look so amazing. Hold on, let me get the stills ready." And this is why, when I'm in an area where there's a lot going on, I'm rolling 4K photo and I'm just walking and I'm slowly moving. I'm not going like this because I'm gonna get motion blur, right? I'm just kind of shooting like this. I mean, sometimes if you're in an area where everyone's taking pictures, I go like this too. But I like to. If I'm keeping this in line with my vision and I'm shooting wide, which is how I prefer to shoot, the camera's doing most of the work for me. It's a real fun and loose way to shoot. It's not a way to be accurate. It's a way to really kind of capture what's in front of you while still being present, which was the case here. Because this guy blows my mind. Look at that. He's like, what up? There we go. That's looking pretty cool. You know, and he's got his smartphone too, so he can keep in touch with his family on Facebook. It's amazing. Oops, did that work out? It did. So let me re-import that. So this is the kind of stuff I do usually in camera. I can just pull this, because this is something that, you know, you shoot and you're like, oh, I'll wait till I get home. It's like, no, I'm gonna do this now. I'm gonna do this right now. So you shoot it, you Wi-Fi it, you crop it, add your filter, and you email it out, and you'd be like, you wouldn't believe what I saw. You know, you ever see posts online on like Facebook, and are like, well, if you don't have a picture, it's not real. Now it is. But this shooting like this is a ton of fun. There was other people bicycling around as well. I want to show you this one here. this one, I had the camera running coming out after at a taco in one hand, actually, and the camera, and I went outside. This was in LA as well, and I wanted I saw this really cool young skater girl coming down the street. I thought she would look cool with the backlight. So I had a camera like this because I'm kind of like, you know, having a taco and shooting. And that was kind of like a gift, right? So that's kind of cool. So that's one frame. I didn't realize I shot that until afterwards. Oops. And then I'll play it. And here she comes. She is awesome. I mean, look at her. She's confident. She's got the glow behind her. It just looks so cool. I'm going to click this over a couple more. There we go. And you know, when you're shooting street, you're shooting people on the street, everyone's a little different how you like our feet to be. You know, how you want it to be up, touching the ground. You can kind of pick and choose. I got a cool lens flare going on here. I'm going to re-import this. Let's do these three. There they go. And then from this one here, I think I'm just going to make this quickly black and white. Done. That's my kind of post process right there. Quick. All right. And then here, I think what I want to do, you know, if you're cropping like this, it's like, yeah, you're going to get more grain or whatever, but if you're going to shoot free, it sure is nice to be able to, look at that. That's still a lot of detail. It's really nice to be able to kind of just have fun with it. Let's do chrome. That looks pretty cool. And now, you know, and I can go back and I can do it again and again and again, but the thing is, one short video clip has given me a ton of content. Some other things I'll do when I'm traveling, I'll show you two different shots, and then I'm going to get a little more advanced in Photoshop. This guy was whizzing down. This is in San Francisco. He was just whizzing down these hills, and as quickly as I could hit record, he was already from the corner here. I mean, this guy goes by quick. Oops. There he is. And away he goes. Here, and again, pull that frame, can bring it right in. Oops. It's a cool way to shoot sports. There he is. And then I did one recently in Tucson. This is with the FZ1000, the previous one was at the LX100. Here he comes, probably about as fast as a bicyclist. Boop, a little too fast, kind of pick and choose. You can see how this kind of work would be really useful with sports and a variety of subjects that move quick. And then again, I could pull the frame. So you get the idea. That stuff is fun, and there's a huge amount of applications for it. Now, let me show you this other one I shot last week. This is with the LX100 in the oldest pub in Arizona, in Bisbee. If you don't know where Bisbee is, it's about an hour from the border. It's a small little mining town. And it was late, and you know, let the good times roll, you're on vacation. But when you have autofocus and video and you got face detection, it'll do the work for you. Did you see that? So I did a rack focus for me because it's looking for a face. He didn't get the shot, by the way. But that's my buddy Matt, that really, really cool designer, and we wanted to go hang out. I've not seen him in years, and went to this pub, playing some pool, having a good time. And you know, I got this image, and here the background is clean. But I see this guy, and he's there. And he's in some other shots, right? Maybe I don't want him in the shot, but I still want Matt kind of like this. So let's see what we can do about that. We can do this. export that frame, come back to where I want that. Not done a composite with this image yet. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna kind of paint him out. Let's just open Photoshop. So what I'm gonna do is, because I got video 4K, right, of the guy in the frame and without, can easily lay those on top of each other. I don't know how much I move the camera though, but I can lay them on top of each other and see if I can erase the guy. So there he is, and then here is this one. Okay, so there's that one, but I really wanted that one. I'm gonna do this real quick and sloppy, but you'll get the idea. Goodbye. And now I'm able to, with a video clip, I mean, to spend this amount of time to get this result is fantastic. I mean, think about this application. You can do this for landscapes. You can do this for, I mean, shots of your friends playing pool. If you wanna do stuff like an HDR, really cool HDR videos, you can do an exposure for the top, the middle, the foreground, and combine it together. Because we're shooting every frame as 8 megapixels, you get a tremendous amount of detail. And by the way, the black and white and the crop I made in camera. So that even shortened my workflow even more. I mean, that was not even 5 minutes and I got what I wanted. Cool. Ah, this one. You ever try to shoot out of the window and stuff? It's not safe, but not fun. But it's fun, but not safe. But I was in a passenger. My wife was driving. This is not the best shot. I mean, you can see reflection in the window. I get that. But here comes these bikers. That's pretty cool. I mean, this is amazing for video. I mean, right? This is like crazy. Then if I want to get a lot of my personal work, I do a lot with blurs and grain, so this is kind of really graphic here. And now I got these cool, especially that second one, that real graphic image. It's like Easy Rider. It's blurry, it's gritty. We can get real crazy with it if I want, but I mean, you can shoot like this all day long. I've gone out for days, just nothing with 4K photo, and I'm able to shoot, and I pull a frame, and I Wi-Fi it, and I'm sending it off. I mean, this is amazing, the power in this kind of technology. All right, so commissions. I'm gonna move on from the personal work. I wanna talk about some of the stuff that you can do with this as applied to commissions. So I've been shooting full-time for 10 years, and it goes like this. You know, everything kind of comes in waves. It's very cyclical, and I was always, in 2009, I got into video because I didn't work for 6 months. After winning a handful of Addy Awards, I didn't work for 6 months. And when that happens, you have this, among other emotions and things that go through your head, you're like, okay, I need to expand what I do. I don't want to shoot video, it scares me. But I've not worked in 6 months. And that's when I started to, I said, well, I'm either going to go do something else, which wasn't an option, or figure out video and somehow create video that works from my mindset, which is a still photographer. So that's when I started getting into the things, pioneering a lot of the techniques you saw early on with that animated portrait, which a lot of people call cinemagraphs. Did a bunch of that stuff early on, and that is what helped me grow my business. And now I'm shooting more animated style photography for commissions than I am for stills. The nice thing is, because my clients hire me for this content that I shoot 4K for, I also have the stills from that to offer them as an additional license. Because when you're shooting commercial work, you don't sell the photo, because I'm not making prints, I'm selling a license. So they're basically renting the image for X amount of time and X in a particular location. So when I shoot 4K video, I got the looping video, I got the animated portrait, the cinemagraph, but then I can pull that frame out and then they could use that in a print ad, and that's an additional revenue stream that takes me like 5 minutes to do. It's an amazing way to stand out and to grow your business in a time when it's really challenging to be a still photographer. So let's go into a couple. Let's see, what am I going to do first? I'll let you guys choose. Rock Band or drones?
Rock Band.
Okay, easy enough. So I only brought a few of these. I got called right around Christmas by an ad agency that works at Anheuser-Busch. And so we're shooting this Rock Band in Mexico for a new a Mexican brand beer. And you're one of the only people that can do this. And can and you want to do it? And yeah, of course, if the you know if it works out, negotiations. But there really was no negotiating because I'm one of the few people that can do this and do it in as fast as I do, because I'm using these tools to do a lot of the creation and camera pulling frames. It was able to give them rich amount of content in a very quick amount of time. I think we were down there in Guadalajara on December 23rd, and they had it just a few days after Christmas finished. And I had my check that day too, which is pretty cool. But it's a band called Maná. Maná is one of the biggest Latin American rock bands ever. I didn't know this until I went and met the guys and stuff. And they just wanted cinemagraphs. And I'm gonna show you a screen capture that is pulled off of their Facebook page. I don't know if you could see, but that's a lot of views from an animated photo. It's a lot of views. And it's hard to get that kind of traction on just a still photo, and that's actually the piece right there. So it's an animated portrait, or some people call them cinemagraphs. Essentially, what we're doing. Oops, is that the wrong one? It's the wrong one, but that's okay. I'll show you in this one. So essentially, what we're doing is we're taking. We're taking a video clip, right? The 4K video. We're putting it into a. Let me close this out. I can actually open it up and show you. We're taking the actual video. Okay, so that's the drummer Alex playing. And when I shot these, this was with the GH4, I did actually put a microphone on. I wanted to capture good quality audio because that potentially could be for something else down the road as well to offer your client and continue that revenue stream going. Plus, it's like getting your own private concert from a world-class band with your head in the drums. So I was like, yeah, why not? But I'll do that again. So that's the actual capture. Okay, because I'm shooting with a GH4 that has a live view in camera, I don't have to like shoot it and be like, oh my God, I hope it comes out. You know, I'm shooting it, I see it live on the screen. Is it bright enough? Is it not bright enough? I can raise the ISO, the shutter, whatever I need to do because I'm seeing it live. It's like real-time feedback. When you have your camera, when you start getting used to a camera that has a live view, it's like you can't lose. If it doesn't look good, even if you don't know which dial it is, just start turning dials, for God's sakes. I mean, it'll get brighter or darker. You'll get it, I promise. It's really straightforward, and it's a ton of fun. So that's the video, right? And then from the video, we pull out one of those 8-megapixel frames. Remember I was showing you how to do that earlier, right? 4K. We pull that frame out. That's the master frame. That frame is going to live on top of that video, and then we're going to make that video loop underneath it, and we're going to by using a mask. This is the only part of that video that is actually going to be showing. The rest of this area is going to be the still photo. Okay, and this is with Cinemagraph Pro. This is how you kind of crack into this. They probably don't want me showing this, but you know, whatever. this is how you break it down. You got your mask, your master frame, and your video. You can do this in Creative Cloud if you're on a PC, because this app is Mac only. You can do anything you want in Creative Cloud. This app, just Cinemagraph Pro, is just a much quicker and more elegant way to do the work. So let's open it back up. So we have a timeline down here. I just wanted to go to like the sweet spot, and looks like, and I kind of, so this is the sweet spot here, right? Because I don't care about all of that. I just want that. I want to loop that, right? If you want to learn more about making these, put my name in Google or in YouTube. I got lots of tutorials on this. I mask it out. I get the general idea right there. And then from here, if I want to make further adjustments, you can see that I brightened it a little bit, but I can brighten it more if I want, you know. I can add a vignette if I want. There's all sorts of things I can do to it. But this type of workflow, if you're creating in camera, if you're letting the technology be your friend and letting it do the heavy work for you, and if you're focusing on being a creative individual, which is what you are, when you get to this point, I mean, this post-production is quick. I mean, I did a lot of these while I was actually enjoying a Montejo. So, and then you just export it. You either export it online or you export it to a file, and that's what you deliver. I'll show you another one. So, oops, I think we went over that one already. Let's see. So here's another one that I did as well. This is less of what we would consider a cinemagraph and more so just a looping video. But real simple, real basic, gets a ton of views online. They're fun to shoot. And again, I could always pull a frame out and offer that frame to the client because I'm shooting 4K. When I started working on my animated photography in 2009, that was like some of the first DSLRs were coming out that shot video. And each one of these, between the DSLRs being really difficult to do this kind of work in camera and the post-production, I was looking to 12 to 14 hours per video. It was really tricky because there was no autofocus, the screens weren't good. I know it's different with DSLRs, but if you're gonna do this kind of work, you're still gonna be years ahead with one of these. Even if you get one of these to supplement your DSLR, you'll still be further ahead. Okay, now let's go into this project I did for 3D robotics. 3D robotics is, I'm gonna upgrade that. 3D robotics is a drone company. They're making this new product, which they announced already, called the Solo. It's an amazing, essentially it's like a flying camera. It's pretty crazy. And he wanted me to do a bunch of cool animated pieces for their launch, for animated GIFs, for email blasts online. They want to be able to pull frames. They just wanted content, and sometimes I get hired by companies like 3DR just to make a library of images, which is a ton of fun because then you just kind of go about and create, which is pretty cool. So what I came back with was I was using LED lights, and I was painting with light. You can kind of see my elbow there, right? Now, in case you're wondering what I was looking at there, I had my iPad off to the side. It was live streaming from the GH4. Because I was gonna shoot this, I was shooting this by myself, I didn't have an assistant there. And I needed the lights to move over the Solo while I was recording. So the iPad was over here, the camera was here, and I had off camera the lights, and I'm kind of painting this drone with my Felix LED lights. So I'm gonna let this play, we can kind of see what's going on. And this is the raw capture, so what you see is exactly how I shot it. That's not the peace symbol, that's take two, in case you're wondering. There we go. So you see my elbow gets in the camera, right? Because we're using a mask, I don't have to show that part in the master frame. I can pick a different master frame. But you see what I'm doing there? I'm kind of taking a light on a light stand, I'm just kind of painting over, making a cool scan line. And because I'm seeing a live view, this time with through the GH4 via the iPad, I can see this and I get exactly what I need, and then I go back and I make my adjustments. And I did this a few times. I did some other ones here that are pretty rad. And then, why don't I show you? So the actual files. This is 4K photo in a square crop. I love square crop. I wanted to try some different stuff with a square crop. And here I'm building a lens flare. So for this one, I was just kind of doing a little more atmospheric type of work. It's very subtle, but this stuff, you know, client loves this stuff. This one's pretty fun too. I'm going to show you some finished images. So here's that one that's finished. Let's see what this looks like. That's the finished animated product shot. You don't see my elbow in there because I just basically chose a master frame that didn't have the elbow in it. And when we open up the file, there's a sweet spot down in the bottom, right? I did no adjustments to the image because I built all that in the camera. Again, with the live view, it's priceless. And I go over to the mask, and there's my mask. Again, no elbow, because I don't need it, right? And then I just export it and I'm done. It's a very fast way to do this kind of work. And then here is the final version that the client gets, 4K, with a MOV wrapper. Remember we talked about wrappers? So MOV and MP4. I shot it in MP4, but the client wanted it delivered in an MOV wrapper for their needs. So I just exported it with that wrapper, which contains the stills, right, and the audio track. In this case, no audio track because it's silent. And then I also gave them an animated GIF, so they can use this in email campaigns. Can you tell the difference between an animated GIF and a video, quality-wise? Yeah, animated GIFs. If you can at all avoid animated GIFs, except for like cat ones or, you know, fun ones like that, try to do so. You can see the difference, because what we're dealing with on an animated GIF is 256 colors. So it takes us back to 1984 video games, right? You can see it definitely in the gradations. And a file size can be pretty large. If you're doing this in 4K, it's smooth, and you get all the colors that your camera can capture, so millions of colors. But for their needs, they needed an animated GIF as well, and I delivered that. And let's see, let's go down. Let's see. So here's the original capture. There's another one. It's another one from a lower angle. So when you shoot like this with live view, with the camera doing a lot of the work, you can create a lot of content quick. So I went and did different colors. Did some red. I mean, this is just a matter of changing the color of the light, painting it over, and hitting record again on the iPad. We did some really cool abstract ones. Very subtle. And that one, you can see how we made that. Very subtle. That's like this is the image in Cinemagraph Pro. And then here's the original capture. So here, what I'm doing is, because I use LED lights, you have to use LED lights for videos. I'm just taking the dimmer and I'm just making it brighter and then dimming it down. Real straightforward. And then from this, if I didn't want to pull frames, I got this one I could pull a frame from. I could pull a frame from that one. And then I did these, which I think this one or one of the other ones was in their launch video. See, normally trying to get the cool reflection in the 3DR and show that logo is really difficult. And again, this is where the live view is a lifesaver, because if I'm over here, and I'm looking at it, I have a different reflection angle from the lights than the camera does. So for me, I could see it with my naked eye and say, oh, that looks great, but the camera's picking up something different. But because I had the iPad on the table and I can see what the camera saw as I did it, it was just a matter of kind of sweeping the light over a few times and kind of getting it just right. So that was the actual raw capture. And then this is the final piece. Smooth, nice loop, and it's just an endless loop. And this is an image that they'll use if they want in print, they'll use them in email campaigns with the animated GIF, they'll use it at trade show videos. And because I'm shooting this, again, with the cameras doing the heavy work, with me putting a focus on the creativity, my workflow is very, very quick. Now, I just want to briefly talk about how to present the work, because it's cool to create this stuff, it's fun, but you want to share it. By the way, I don't think I showed you this. This is one awesome way to shoot and present and do everything. This is the Lumix CM1. It is Panasonic's first smart camera. It has Android built in. It's always connected to the web. A lot of the post-production I was showing you, pulling frames and all that, you just do it right here. Deliver, email, everything off this camera. And it actually has the same sensor as this camera. So it's got a large sensor, it's got a Leica lens, and something that's not much larger than my iPhone. It's pretty awesome. So yeah, you can do your 4K photo with this too, which is amazing. So you're always shooting amazing 4K with this stills, 20 megapixel stills, including RAW with this. And you can back up to Lightroom, and it's like, this excites me because this is the future of the system. And this will hopefully be out soon. I'm not sure when, but that'll be a question for my friends at Panasonic once we're done. But I had to show you this because this is awesome. Okay, so how do you present this stuff? So we're seeing how to shoot it, pulling frames. We all get that. How do you present it? Because that's the thing. If you're shooting cool content, and you know, when we shot prints, you make a print portfolio or a printed image on a wall. Well, you present this work just like you would with your printed work, because we're pulling frames, you make your print products, you can do all that cool stuff with prints because it is a photograph, right, at maybe 30 frames a second. But what about the animated stuff, the videos? We all have these, which we talked about earlier, right? So if you are on a Creative Cloud account, I want to talk about a couple ways. Oops, went ahead too far, but there's one way to do this. That's with Behance. So if you're on Adobe Creative Cloud account, you get Behance for free, and you get a portfolio app. I think you can actually get on Behance without a Creative Cloud account, right? Okay, so it's free, so you should do it because it's free and it looks great. But this is a great way to show all of your work, your stills, your animated portraits. It holds everything. You put it on the Behance network. Think of it as Facebook for artists, minus the trolls, which is super cool, minus the sarcasm and nothing but a bunch of cool people around the world making amazing art, supporting each other. Great place to find jobs if you're looking for jobs, and a great place to connect with other artists. And it's I don't know how many millions of artists around the world, but really, what's up?
And get hired.
Yeah, so you can even get hired. So if you're a weekend warrior, an excellent place to get work. And this is where you can show a lot of your work. You can show your videos, your stills, and they have a portfolio app for the iPad. I believe it's on Android and also like the iPhone as well. So this is a very effective way to show your work. If you're on the go, you just put it on your phone. It's all synchronized. And it even comes with a website, a good website, by the way, and it's all synchronized. So you put it on a Behance network, it goes to your pro site, it goes to your portfolio apps instantly. And then there's a community there that's supportive. It's very cool. That's a doable way. And what I'll do sometimes is I'll have a meeting with a potential client. I'll run a deck on this on my MacBook Pro, just like I'm doing now. And I'll hand an iPad around and pass it around, let them kind of look at the interactive stuff. So that is how to present this, your 4K and what we call hybrid photography.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.